And welcome to another episode of Entrepreneur India's Smart Investing Series. I'm Shipra Singh. I am Chief Correspondent at Entrepreneur India, and I'll be moderating today's panel. So this week's episode is focused on equity investing, and we'll kind of draw up a comparison between the two, you know, the two most popular avenues of equity investing, which is through stocks and mutual funds. So the primary focus of our discussion is to inform small investors about whether one should take the MF route or the direct stocks route, and if you're taking the direct stocks route, then what are the common mistakes to avoid? So let me start the session by laying the ground rule for our attendees. Please sit in the area with maximum internet signals to avoid any lag during the webinar. We'll be putting up polls during the webinars. Please do participate. And all attendees will automatically be muted, but we encourage participation. So please drop your questions in the Q&A box right at the bottom of the screen and on Facebook Live for those who are attending the Facebook Live. We will spend approximately 15 minutes at the end of the session to answer questions. So please stay with us. Keep your questions ready. Drop them in the Q&A box or Facebook Live, and we'll take up each and every question. So let me start the session by introducing our speakers today. We have with us Archana, who's the co-founder and CEO of PickRight. She's in charge of product ownership, marketing, partnerships, and growth, among other things at PickRight. She has previously worked with a global financial services firm UBS and a Silicon Valley startup that was later acquired by Oracle. So PickRight is not her first stint. As in 2014, she founded a startup in the B2C space for hobbypreneurs called WantHandmade.com. After facing intense operational pressure, she had to wrap it up, and then she joined ShopX, and eventually she founded PickRight. And her vision behind creating PickRight is to create a company that makes investing as easy as ordering food, you know, from online delivery platforms. Welcome, Archana. Thank you very much for joining us today.
Thanks for a lovely introduction. Thank you, Shiv.
Our second speaker is Harsh Jain. He's the co-founder and COO of Grow. Harsh heads customer acquisition, retention, and business expansion at Grow. And prior to Grow, Harsh has been product manager at Flipkart, where he built products for marketplace and logistics. He has also been founder of a storytelling startup named Runjun Stories. And Harsh is an IIT Delhi graduate with a BTech in Electrical Engineering and a Master's in Information and Communication Engineering. Welcome, Harsh. Thank you very much for joining us today.
Thanks, Shipra.
So we'll begin the discussion. And, I want to start by pointing out a very interesting trend that I have noticed when I was kind of collating data for this discussion, which is that there's been, in the last four to five months, direct investment in the stock market appears to have found favor among retail investors. And this is despite the volatility, brought on by the COVID-19 pandemic in the ensuing lockdowns. So, on one hand, we have AMFI data, which shows that net inflows and equity mutual funds have plummeted. And, if one has to simply infer, it would be that, because of the volatility, people are moving out. But on the other hand, other brokerage firms and have reported a massive surge in the number of investors, who are opening accounts for direct equity investment, and that there are large trading volumes, delivery, etc. So I want to ask both of you, both of you can take turns to answer this question. What do you think is actually driving this retail behavior, this sudden shift from, to direct stock trading?
Yeah. Okay. I'll go. So, yeah. So I think the main sudden shift is two things. One, the pandemic literally forced everyone to be in the houses and having time. And basically for stock trading, it cannot be your main job. As you are going to office and doing, you have a family to take care. You cannot do trading at that time. You need to be a long-term investor. But the main thing now, the pandemic has actually given time for everyone. And like even in US, you know this Robin Hood investors, like we have discount brokerages like Zerodha, and now Grow also has come in.
Yeah.
So the reach, the digital reach to the traders has increased, and because of free opening of accounts and the less brokerage charges, in the sudden dip which has come in March, people started investing and quickly realizing 20%, 30%, 40% returns. And that's where people, so there are two sides of this coin. One, great, everyone started getting interest into investing and trading. This negative side, it is more like people think that actually they have aced the market, or they know how to control the market, or they can predict the market. But that's the biggest challenge. Market cannot be predicted. So I think both of these things, because of the reach, the digital sitting at home and the knowledge, and of course, people are talking about it and everyone wants to go put money here, put money they take out. And that's what encouraged people to start trading. For us, for India, it's especially really good because we have a very less percentage of population who actually trade or invest. So any type of opening or encouragement awareness is very right for the for this particular generation, because going ahead, it's all investing.
So I would agree with you, Archana. So the trends we are observing now, lot of people are at home, and what we're talking about, the new set of new, like the investors who are coming in the industry, if you look at the age, if you look at what segment they are the younger millennials, like 25 to 35, 40 years old people. Now, the disposable income in their hands is increasing now. Obviously, they don't have much to spend. They are sitting at home. They have much more time to study, research. I mean, how much ever they're capable to do, but they still have more time to spend before, you know, investing in any product. And also, this is a kind of, you know, the markets are volatile. Then there are more, you will anyway see more interest, because people can see that how, you know, the money is moving up and down within a few days, whether it's for the right direction that they're learning from it, or it's just from the entertainment point of view. But both ways, volatility adds more interest from the investors. So that is the reason primarily why, you know, the stocks investment is increasing. Obviously, you have the broader global reasons that there are the other asset classes like real estate and others are not as attractive. So people would want to have an alternate source of income in the long term. They would want to have diversified investments. And being digital, being more accessible because of the you know, digital products, the apps and the websites, which are making onboarding very simple, very easy. So there is a way for them to get into it. There is a knowledge, information available, time available, and there is an incentive for them to do. So all the three, you know, check boxes are there for people to get into it. But having said that, Shipra, just I want to add one thing. So you compared mutual funds, you know, degrowth, so to say. So that's a very industry level phenomenon, not really with the retail investor. So we on our platform, we are probably, you know, we are kind of representing the retail investors in mutual funds on Grow, and we are seeing continuous increase in the number of SIPs or the equity investment inflows also. Okay. So while the interest for stocks is going, and maybe that's going 4x, 5x from January, February numbers, but mutual fund in retail investors who are again digital savvy in the same millennial population, then it's not going down. Okay. It's still, I mean, we would still be, if we are doing 150,000 new SIPs a month now, we would be doing maybe 50,000, 60,000 in, you know, mid of last year, maybe in January a lakh. So this has been increasing continuously month over month. And the shift is more in the millennials and the new generation, I would say.
Okay. So, I mean, you both, you know, I mean, whatever you said is completely true. But that said, I mean, I don't think just disposable income and time is not enough. You also require a kind of skill set, because stock selection is a Herculean task. So, you know, like there are over 5,000 listed stocks. And if I only have to look at the top 50, which make up the largest market capitalization, even looking at how the top three performers and underperformers, you know, on Nifty 50 since, say, 2016, it indicates how difficult it is to identify the top performers. So in that case, I mean, just having time, disposable income is enough. Do you think that? And, you know, is stock investing really for everyone? Because yes, of course, everybody wants to make money, but what are the chances of losing money than making money? So what do you have to say on that? Is it really for everyone just because you have the time for it?
I'll Harsh can take this. I have taken the first one.
No worries. So, Shipra, is the stocks for everyone? I mean, my answer would be yes. My answer would be yes. So for the people who, so for whom stocks is not the right investment, is someone who doesn't want to, you know, doesn't want to get higher returns, doesn't want to increase their net worth over long term, doesn't want to, I mean, he's happy with the, is happy with, you know, the fixed deposits or the cash lying in the bank, is happy with the real estate or the gold or different asset classes. It's really happy and satisfied, and it's not a bad thing. It is just a different mindset, I would say. But for anyone else, I wouldn't disqualify a person who is not yet informed, not yet knowledgeable about equity and capital market to be able to invest in the stocks or direct equity.
So, you know, why I ask is that, you know, often when I speak to case studies for my stories, I've come across people, you know, who entered the stock market, you know, for whatever reason, maybe because their friends encouraged them to, or just, you know, what we call FOMO, fear of missing out. They dabble in stock, they lose money, and then, I mean, they are gone forever from stock. Then they don't even want to take the, you know, the safer route of mutual funds or whatever. So from that, you know, a point, from that place, I'm asking that how should retail small investors really look at stocks, you know? I mean, of course, there's never a right or wrong time or whatever, however you want to put it. But again, you know, is it really for everybody? Because I think it also, here I think I would like to touch upon the, you know, the point of risk appetite. Maybe people have, I mean, they just look at returns, but what they don't, don't look at is that there's also a very huge risk involved.
I completely agree. See, that's what I wanted to just touch upon that. I come up from a, though I started my career in UBS Swiss Bank, but I later on, I was a core product tech architect person, and I managed teams and launched great tech products. So I come from a non-financial background. And for me, as a common person, for me, having that research, to have the skills to do the research, which is both fundamental and technical, and having that time, is a definitely a mammoth and a Herculean task, right? Knowing what the company's fundamentals are, where it has, and what the investments are, cash flows. It is not every person's cup of tea. And see, and I think the, while you rightly said, stock market investing in equities is not for everyone, because it is not just entry. It is about averaging and exiting. Right time to average and right time to exit. When this happens, then only in the long term, or even in the short term or whatever term, gains can be. Otherwise, people just dabble, they come, they dip their feet, and then they lose money. And that's exactly how equity. But having said that, if you have a right self-directed platform,
okay,
and if you have a right advisory, which we are actually, PickRight is trying to build. But if you have, keeping that aside, if you have right advisory who actually does this particular research, not at a interest level where they have to promote penny stocks or what because of the commissions or anything, but if someone does in a right way the research and does the exact what stocks, when to enter, average and exit, then equity is really a best bet for any investor, in the long term or in the short term. But again, not everyone has access to that type of research, neither time and patience. So we need to rely on the third party, somewhere outsource it.
And to add to that, Chipra, when I said everyone, whoever desires to get higher returns, they should invest. So when I'm, so both the things, like right from, you don't need to invest 100% of your income.
Of course.
You know, so people who are not understanding and not able to take their own calls, can have a lower investment. You can have as low as 5% of your portfolio. So that you have the 95% probably in mutual funds or any other product that you believe in and understand them. But having, if you desire to have higher returns, if you desire to participate in the growth story, India growth story, and you, desire to have long-term goals to be met, financial goals, then everyone should ideally be investing. They may take help from advisors, of course, if they're not able to do on their own. So it's more like, you know, you want to climb Mount Everest, right? But if you don't start, then you can never. Some of the people, that's okay. But some of the people will take others' help and then they will climb. So it's free to, you know, at least go for it. That's the reason why everyone should start investing, and then they'll figure out what's the right thing and the best thing.
So, you know, what Archana said about, I mean, if you don't have the skill set, then maybe, you know, looking at professional advisory or whatever. In that sense, do you think mutual funds is a more suitable avenue for the uninformed investor, because they have experienced and skilled managers to look after the portfolio? So in that sense, do you think that's the better route to maybe start with, if not direct stock investing?
Yeah, see, mutual funds, definitely, if you ask me, yeah, probably to start with for an uninformed investor, they might be a great avenue to start getting into investing. But having said that, even choosing the right mutual fund is still a task, right? Even in a direct platform where you can go and invest in the direct mutual funds, you need to really know what is that mutual fund, whether it suits you. You used the right word, which actually we are building a smart profiling, risk appetite. Hyper-personalization is one thing which needs to be coming into investment sector. And it is that's where, if I go to a direct mutual fund, there might be buckets of mutual funds, great mutual funds, which actually matched my age and everything, but not right to my investment thesis. What is the sector probably I have invested in earlier? What should I be investing? So that level of intelligence still a user or an investor should be having when they have to put into a mutual fund. Again, when they go with a distributor, the same challenge. Distributor should be working for the investor to understand more and tell what they have to do than go for a distributor commission. Right? So, I'll just end with one line. For an investor to invest, it is not just the previous 2 years, 3 years return where a fund must have given 20%, 30% returns, but knowing where the complete asset allocation of the fund is and what is his or her risk appetite thesis. And that's where, but to start with mutual fund is a right way to start, at least to see how it is, because it is all sorted out and there are fund managers who can take care of it.
Yeah. Anything you would like to add here, Harsh?
Yeah, absolutely. So mutual funds are very, very good products and they're for masses. There are fund manager, professional fund managers sitting out there who are taking the calls. And sorry, this is some pop-up.
Okay, it's the poll.
All right. Yeah. So definitely people should invest in mutual funds. And again, I'll reiterate the point. So I think it's a balance, right? You know, and the younger you are, you have a higher risk appetite and you have more, interest in how your investments are doing. I mean, it's not really a black box. This younger generation, they want to see what's happening with their investments. So that is why you have mutual funds, which you are invested in, you are secured, you can do continue your SIPs. And those that is your savings and investments, your goals are being met. And on the top of it, if you have interest and if you have, time or access to the right advisory or the right information that you understand and consume, then you can start some part in the equity at some time. And then overall, you balance between the two. So it's very difficult to, compare these two products. I think both of them are required in a good portfolio.
Yeah, of course.
How much of which depends on how much time you can spend in and how much help you can get from it.
Yeah, so this is essentially, what you just said is, essentially refers to diversification. So this is my next question, and this is a very interesting one. I've often, heard people have these conversations so for instance, now that the market, it rallied between May to July, has your mutual fund scheme given you similar returns as compared to a large cap stock in that period and all those things? And then they go on to say that, if not, then what is the point of investing in mutual funds? Why can't you invest with direct in stocks? So I think in such conversations, what is lacking is people don't really understand the point of diversification, which mutual fund helps you, kind of achieve. Because in a mutual fund, a fund manager is typically investing in, say, 50 stocks. And, there would be large cap stocks and then there would be mid cap stocks and all those things. So, let me ask you, Archana, do you hear these kind of queries from your clients?
Like mutual funds did perform.
Yeah, yeah.
In fact, I am one of them. I strong. See, that's exactly why I started PickRight. I said PickRight needs to be a platform where diversification is the name of the game.
Yes.
Entry, average, exits are the rules of the game. And it's not just like what Harsh was touching upon. It is not just about mutual funds and equities. In fact, mm-hmm. we are building a platform where you can actually diversify in alternate instruments as well. Mm-hmm. There is so much out there where based on different user behaviors, risk appetites, terms, goals, timelines, when they want to actually get the money. For the millennials, mutual fund is a long wait game. You need to be really invested. So that's where, and definitely see, when I say mutual funds didn't perform, there is always a period where mutual funds can hit stagnancy and then they pick it up. So yeah. patience is really a virtue here, right? So people need to be very patient. And when you say whether they gave returns, what is returns? It's again perspective. For me, 10% is a great return probably.
Yeah.
For someone, 20% is a great return. For some, no, 50-60% should be out there because I'm putting my great earned money because I'm mm-hmm. entitled for it, right? So that's where the biggest challenge what I see is it's always we need to keep calm, invested, stay invested in the right mutual fund, and definitely returns would come. But we cannot actually even compare apples to oranges. Mutual funds, as you said, it's actually different portfolios where you have different combinations and different stocks have been taken, and you cannot really compare that with a Reliance rally or a Glenmark rally, yeah. which has happened right now, right?
True.
6 months, 7 months is nothing. When you are talking about data, we need to really compare the historic. And again, as I again said, it's very important to pick the right mutual fund or the right investment, which you can afford, and it should support your thesis. It should support your different personalization. Yes. Then definitely, I think every investment will return, and that's where mm-hmm. Mutual funds too are pretty good in instruments. I felt it, but I want to keep invested in that.
We also have a question from one of our viewers, Lalit Sulanki. Lalit, please switch on your mic so that we're handing over the mic so you can ask the question directly to our speakers. Lalit Sulanki.
Hello, like I'm audible?
Yeah, please go ahead, Lalit.
Yeah, actually, my doubt is that people say that you should always go for long-term investment, right? So, like, I always wonder that, like, if I would have invested 2 years back into a stock market and in a hope of long-term investment, right? And like, then I would have lost my money in this March 2019. I would have lost my money in this March, right? So, like, I'm always confused, like, what is the right time to exit, you know, the stock market? Like, so I always wonder that.
Okay. I'll just answer it then, and probably Harsh can be a bit because he can take it up. I'll just tell this. So one thing is, exiting is not always an option. Averaging is something which we really don't consider doing it. And a long term is anything above, for us, we in PickRight, and for us as a thesis, we think long term is anything above 6 months or 12 months is a long term for us. And when in March the dip happened, if there is money, the smart move was to keep averaging to accumulate more, because what I understand from your question, probably you are well-versed, you know what you're doing. You must have done your research and have put in the right stocks where fundamentals are strong. And if you know these are the stocks, then people should keep averaging. And if they are the stocks which they don't hold any strength, then of course, that's exactly what stock market teaches us, that always go for fundamentals and technical analysis over gossips and rumors. So I would suggest that keep on averaging if you know they are the strongest stocks than exiting. And that will actually give you more returns. And long term, again, it depends. Anything above 1 year is a long term to me. So Harsh, to you.
Yeah. So very, very short answer to that is you should exit when you need the money.
Okay.
So if you have done your homework, right? If you have whether you're buying stocks or the mutual funds, and you have gone through the process of, you know, why you want to invest in that company or in that mutual fund. If you don't need the money, then don't exit. That's a very, very short, simple answer is what I feel is the right thing to do. Having said that, see, anytime you see there's a fundamental change in the company or in the industry, which is going to affect it in long term, or in case of mutual funds, when you see the fundamental, you know, change because the company, that investment strategy, if you go that level, that investment strategy itself is not now applicable. So most of the times a smart or right chosen fund manager or a fund would have taken that step and changed things. But if you still disagree, then that's a thing. That's a time where either, you know, you exit and put investments in other products, or you just exit it and you see. But just timing the market is not really a, you know, I mean, it's not really the best thing that has worked for people.
Understood. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Lalit. So I'll take one more question from Facebook. So one of our viewers writes that if someone is expecting 7-8% returns from their investment, is equity really an appropriate vehicle for them? Who would like to take this?
So it's a quick, before I get into the, you know, the details, I would say, see, equity is not an equity, like it's not one product. You know, there are hundreds of companies listed, like good companies out there listed, and expecting 7-8% returns it's a fair. I mean, if that is the expectation, I think there are a lot more safer venues also possible, both from and even equity also. You can look at the companies who've been growing consistently at that growth, who are very, you know, big in size, as much as you can consider how the country's GDP is going to grow for next 3 years, 5 years, and that kind of impact they will have on that company also. So there are different ways to figure out, you know, if you have the set goal in your mind, how you can achieve that. But that doesn't get disqualify equity or mutual funds. I think you can plan again. So the difference between short term and long term in the goals is, like, if you have a 7-8% or 9-10 or 15-20, whatever is your expectation in a long term, then don't worry about the ups and downs in the short term.
Yeah, true.
Because if you're thinking that, okay, in 5 years, I want a cumulative return of X percentage. So then 1 year, 2 years, it can be double of it, or it can be half of it. It could be negative also. But if you have the appetite to see that, how that's going and be able to stay with it and not, you know, exit if the fundamentals were right and your investment choice was correct, then you will achieve it.
All right. Okay. One more question. What is the optimum number of mutual funds and stocks to have in one's portfolio? Archana, why don't you take that?
It's a very subjective question. It depends on what exactly users, how much he has a capital, how much he can put it, how much he can diversify, what is his risk appetite. So ideally, it depends on, so if he is a moderate risk, then probably we would say put around 50% in mutual funds and 50% in equity, in equity returns, where you can get, like what Harsh was saying, in the fundamentally strong stocks, and you can do. But if you are a very, very low risk taker, then probably I would suggest more on your mutual funds. Right, you're on debt funds, and you can actually then go ahead and see and slowly start getting into equity funds, and then see, then get into stock market investing. Because again, as we know, stock market investing is not every, it's, you need someone, you need to understand. You cannot be just going with the herd mentality or looking at the news and buying, because nobody can predict what's going to happen. So it again depends on the user profiling, based on how much money they want to invest, and based on the risk, we would say 30% or 70%. That's where I would suggest.
All right. Okay, we'll take one more question from Rishabh Ketan. He's attending on Zoom. Rishabh, please ask your question to our speakers. Please switch on your mic. Rishabh, you're muted. You need to unmute your speaker. Okay, I think it's not getting through. So I'll ask on behalf of Rishabh. His question is, what is your view on forex trading? Harsh, do you want to take that?
No views. I mean, my answer is simple, right? If you understand, See, trader is a very different mentality than investors.
True. Small investors. Yeah.
If you have that neck, and if you understand how the markets move, what are the factors? You know, what that changes the currency rates. And if you are, really, really keen, then I mean, start small and then see how it goes. But no specific, view how where it is going, what it is doing. Maybe Archana, yeah, your question.
No, that's true. So though in Pickright we have Forex trading advisory on it, but again, it again depends on how, even you need to know that you need to be getting currency, you need to enable currency trading in your DMAT account. So it starts from there. It's not just equity trading. And from there, you need to understand how the Forex indices are moving, what factors are exactly impacting your US dollar to change, or what is that foreign policy just now came. And there are so many things which happens, even a 0.01 cent change as well. So I would say go ahead for it. If you really know how to do it, it's a great one of the asset class which is doing well, and it's a niche asset class. Very few players actually do that, and because not everyone can understand Forex moment.
Okay, this is an interesting one. This has come from Facebook. How important is the age factor while investing in different types of products? So I think this gentleman Amit Bangia, he's referring to all kind of investment products, which includes debt, equity, stocks, mutual funds, and all those things. So, who would like to take this?
So, I mean, I'll just add one line, then Archana, you can take it if you want. Younger you are, more time you have for taking the risk, for seeing the effect of the compounding, for diversifying, and a lot of things. So, age, obviously, the only factor I feel is the risk appetite, and not really about the age. It's more of your life cycle where you are. You know, a lot of younger people are nowadays earning really good salaries, and they have a lot of disposable income, and they feel very secure based on their education or the kind of jobs and all. So they have they can go all in. I mean, they can do more investments. They don't need different kind of planning, so they can do different investments. A lot of generation which was above us, now they are financially stable, settled, so they are also able to take risks. Like, for example, my father, he's investing in equity also right now. I mean, he's 60 plus and he's still doing it. But if you generalize things, then age will not have your investment strategy. It's more to do with your risk appetite and goals. That's what I would say.
Anything you would like to add here?
No, I completely resonate with Harsha on that. It's very important to understand yourself when you are investing. How much risk, how much you are, every investment I strongly feel whenever even I'm investing, am I ready to lose this 1 lakh rupees?
Okay.
Yeah. Like I was putting in, I'll just take an example. I was putting in gold commodity exactly when gold was falling. So you should be ready. Like the happiness, I think investing is like your meditation yoga. If you get great returns, you should be calm. If you get loss, you should be calm. That's where you can keep on investing, keep on averaging, and you will see definitely returns in the long term. So it all depends on how much you have the appetite to lose and how much you have the knowledge to invest right.
Okay.
If you don't have enough money to even experiment or to invest, then I should say go ahead and be very safe. Go into the mutual funds, go into the equity, put in the blue chip stocks where you can actually see your 8 to 10% returns, and it is a safe bet. It's very important to see your principal is always protected, whichever age, whichever life cycle, whichever stage you are in. I think that's the advice what I want to give to everyone who is investing.
All right. One last question, we'll take it up. This is on Zoom. Sumail Bang, please unmute your speaker and please ask your question.
Yeah, good afternoon, everyone. So my question is, let's say for a person or for a millennial who's earning 1 lakh a month, and what should be the, considering that FOIR ratio of 0.3 to 70,000, how should you distribute this in mutual funds and stocks? What should be the ideal percentage?
Yeah, Harsh, you want to go ahead, take it?
So I don't know. Again, what's I mean, this answer is not straightforward. So I would say you should have some percentage in equity and some in mutual funds is what how I would start if I were you and I have a saving and I'm young, I don't have too many liabilities on me. Then I would you know put some amount, maybe 40,000 to 50,000 in SIPs, and the rest of the money will be more like a start with the play money, and then over time learn about the stock investing, pick the right companies, start with them, and then keep increasing my exposure if I have the interest and if I'm able to understand the how the direct equity market works. I mean, not really an advice. I think this is what I would do. Sorry, yeah. You
can be, probably in 6 months we will release our self-directed investment platform where we know your 1 lakh how your multiple assets you should be actually divided based on the personalization what we give. But right now, again, I said I'm not really qualified to say just like we're looking where 1 lakh how much 70,000 where you should put it. We need to understand what liabilities everything, and still since you are a millennial, and I would agree with Harsh, start putting it in mutual funds where you know they have the portfolio asset is into the strong where your mutual fund doesn't really tank. And start investing in strong, fundamentally strong equities. Start putting around 40, 30, or even like 40K in mutual funds, 30K in equities, and start playing around. There are different investment options available too as you start in your investment journey.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Okay, so I'll wrap up the discussion with one last question, and I want to both to take up this one by one. So if somebody has to invest in direct equity, what are the three common mistakes that one should avoid? So let's start with you, Harsh.
Okay, so the most, I think people should not chase returns. So, I mean, just don't go by, the numbers that you see on the dashboards. Or, I mean, all the page that this mutual fund or equity that gave so many returns, so much return in the last 1 year, 3 year, 5 years. Definitely that adds some information in your choice, how you should use that. You should see how consistent that has been, how based on the fundamental it has been, things like that. And second, I would say is don't, I mean, if you're investing in stocks per se, then don't get, emotionally attached in the way that don't feel it's a, there's a bias because you took a decision. Now, even if, your decision was wrong, the price is going down and you now believe the fundamentals have changed. But there's a bias. No, I don't want to see losses. I will wait till profit comes. But that's not really the right strategy. Again, it's very, a lot of it depends on how much research you've done, what you believe in and strongly things like that. But don't worry about that. And third, I would say is don't follow the recommendations available on internet and just by the, face value of it. Just do your research because there'll be a lot of people giving you tips, information. There'll be a lot of places. So try to understand, try to question them. So there may be some good advice also, good recommendation also in that noise. But then you have to ask right questions. I mean, you have to ask why three times. And then you'll know if, the person who's recommending you is actually giving you some information. And the same apply on when you're doing on your own research. If you're reading, content and you're reading different news, then also ask the same question. If the company, some publisher is saying this is good option, whether it's a mutual fund, the top mutual fund, or it's a top equity, then just try to find why are they saying. And if you then agree with that, then I mean that you'll make less mistakes, learn more.
All right. What about your account? What do you have to, what are the three things you have to say?
I think Harsh covered all of them. So it's the same. The very first thing is, selling when somebody has to buy, the panic selling needs to be stopped. First thing is, yes, of course, fundamental research. You need to know which stocks you can invest in and what are the stocks, not coming under pressure, not really getting into gossips, rumors, or reading some news and knowing, yes, I need to invest here, and the impulse buying. That is something which people need to control. And thinking, we should be thinking more like a business owner, like how he rightly said it, emotional attachment. It's a business. You need not be that it's not like you got a stock and you're selling it. Keep it. The more, and if you believe it and you understand in and out of the company, start believing in it, average it. And then that's where equity, I think those are the main common mistakes. One is following others, what they're doing, not understanding what really they can buy or they subscribe to. And selling when they should be actually buying. So those are the main mistakes. And research, of course, I wouldn't, fundamental research and technical analysis is top for every person who wants to do equity investment. Otherwise, find a right advisor who can help you to do.
I have one more question here. So I'll quickly take this up and then we'll wrap up. I seem to have misplaced that question. Yeah, so this is again Kishore Dave. He's asking that why is the market firm despite such a huge decline in GDP all over the world, and is it the right time to invest? I think, you know, in fact, this is a very appropriate question, which I also have on my mind, that, you know, I mean, the economy and the markets seem to be behaving exactly opposite. So what do you think is driving it, and is it the right time to invest? And is it the right time to invest is not my question, it is this gentleman's question, but yes.
Yeah, so even, see, we are a PickRight platform. We have one of my co-founders is a registered investment advisor. He has done his MBA, and I ask him every day, say, should I invest today? Tell me, will the market go up? So what's his thesis is, there is no reason, no answer on why markets are behaving like this. And markets can go and up. This volatility will continue till probably next year, even US elections, probably next year till June, when vaccine comes, stabilizes, and people really see through what damage the COVID has done. But having said that, every day start, if you really believe there are 5 stocks which you have done fundamental research, start buying even if there is a minus 0.04 or a 0.1% dip also. So start, keep investing, don't buy. That's exactly what we tell to our clients, and that's what Sid has taught me, that you need to start slowly investing. If you have 1 lakh, distribute it across 10 days or 20 days across all those 4 or 5 stocks and keep on investing, because there is no right time or wrong time to enter into the market. That's what it is. You have to enter somewhere, and Harsh's first sentence, investments has to start somewhere. People have to be self-dependent. They have to, because we are looking at a pensionless retirement and uncertainty. People have to start investing. So start investing small every day, slow, small dips. Keep on investing. No right time, wrong time.
Okay. All right. Anything you would like to add here, Harsh? Any concluding remarks?
No. I think very, very well articulated. I think the right time to invest was yesterday. To start investing was yesterday. So.
Yeah. True. All right. We had a really great session. Thank you, viewers, for taking out the time to attend our discussion today. And thank you, both the speakers, for joining us. It was a very insightful discussion, and I hope that our viewers, got some takeaways from it. Thank you very much again, everybody, and have a good day ahead.
Thanks,
thank you so much. Yeah, thanks.